Well, speaking of road congestion in the United States, for those planning to drive into Manhattan, it will cost you starting January. Passenger vehicles headed to the borough will have to pay a $9 congestion mitigation charge. Now, the program, the first of its kind in the United States, was initially set to charge $15 toll during daytime hours. It was supposed to take effect on June 30, but was delayed after New York Governor Kathy Hochul put it on hold.
This $9 daytime toll is enough to secure the $15 billion in MTA funding that congestion pricing was intended to support. We're still getting the $15 billion to fund the MTA, and drivers are paying $6 less. This lower toll will still allow us to accomplish all, and I mean all, of the goals of congestion pricing. New modern signals, the long-awaited Second Avenue subway, new electric buses, elevators, and this will generate major investments for our suburban commuters as well.
More than 900,000 vehicles enter the Manhattan Central Business District daily, which reduces travel speeds to around 11 kilometers per hour on average. Now, London implemented a similar charge in 2003. The climate experts believe developing countries need at least $1 trillion a year to move to greener energy and fight extreme weather conditions. Money is a central focus of the COP29 climate talks being held in Azerbaijan. The success of the summit is likely to be judged on whether nations can agree a new target for how much richer nations, development lenders, and the private sector must provide each year to developing countries to finance climate action. A previous goal of $100 billion per year, which expires in 2025, was met 2 years late in 2022.
But in all this talk of numbers, among the many acronyms, let's not lose sight of what's really at stake. Cleaner air across the world's megacities, commuters no longer choking as they make their way to work and their return back home. Households who can sleep soundly, knowing a flood or storm will not wash away everything they hold dear. Stopping the devastation and damage, improving lives and livelihoods, and building a better world for everyone.
An update on the weather now. Typhoon Orfel continues to weaken as it moves over the Luzon Strait. Orfel was last spotted 100 kilometers northwest of Calayan, Cagayan, with maximum sustained winds of 120 kilometers per hour and gustiness of up to 150 kph. Wind signal number 3 is still up over the western portion of Babuyan Island and the northwesternmost portions of mainland Cagayan, as well as the northernmost portion of Ilocos Norte. Now, other parts of northern Luzon are still under signal number 1 and 2. Now, Pagasa Weather Bureau says there is a high risk of life-threatening storm surges in the next 48 hours over the coastal localities of Batanes, Ilocos Norte, Ilocos Sur, Cagayan, including Babuyan Islands and Isabela. Now, Orfel will continue to move northwestward and may exit the Philippine area of responsibility this afternoon. Despite exiting PAR, though, wind signals may still be raised over the areas of extreme northern Luzon. As Orfel weakens, severe tropical storm Pepito intensifies. Pepito is nearing typhoon category, packing winds of up to 110 kilometers per hour and gusts reaching 135 kph. The center of the storm was estimated east of Giwan, eastern Samar. Areas under wind signal number 1 include Catanduanes, the eastern portions of Camarines Norte, and the eastern portion of Camarines Sur. Pepito is expected to dump heavy rains and bring severe winds. It may make landfall over the eastern coast or of the central or southern Luzon portions during the weekend at peak intensity. Now, Pepito is forecast to exit PAR Monday afternoon or evening. The Philippine Transportation Chief clarifies the EDSA busway is here to stay despite recent issues surrounding the legal entry of unauthorized vehicles. This and other updates on the transport sector from Johnson Manabat.
There will be no changes in the setup of the EDSA busway. This was clarified by the Department of Transportation following calls to implement a counterflow system to discourage private vehicles from using the exclusive lane. In an ambush interview at the transportation conference in Parañaque City, Transportation Chief Jaime Bautista said they need to study the proposal and consult with stakeholders. This came after the viral video of an SUV carrying a protocol plate meant for senators was flagged down for using the busway. Transportation officials later said the protocol plate was fake.
Hindi naman natin basta-basta may implement yan. Kailangan magkaroon ng hearing. No? We'll have to consult with the stakeholders. No? Narinig natin marami rin nagsasabi na hindi siya dapat gawin. No? So we'll listen to everyone. No? So sa ngayon, we'll continue to operate it as is.
Bautista says the agency's Special Action and Intelligence Committee for Transportation, or SAICT, will strictly implement traffic rules on the EDSA busway as the holiday season approaches. The EDSA busway is just one of the measures to move more people from point A to B. With this in mind, the transportation chief gave updates on the ongoing construction of the Metro Manila Transit Line 7 as well as the Metro Manila Subway project. Bautista said commuters will soon have another transportation option as they aim to partially operate 12 MRT7 stations by the end of 2025. This will cover the stretch of North Avenue to Lagro Station in Fairview. Bautista also reported progress in settling right-of-way issues for the Metro Manila Subway project.
Continues yung ating discussion with landowners. 47 households sa Corinthians, almost kalahati doon nag-agree na. No? And we continue the discussion and dialogue with them.
The agency is also seriously considering the use of cable cars to decongest the metropolis and provide the public another mode of transportation. According to Bautista, there is a study in Japan that suggested a cable car system is suitable in some parts of the country.
A prototype is being studied for installation in Baguio for possible adoption in Antipolo, whose residents can use to connect to MRT4 at the Taytay station.
Secretary Bautista also hopes to see more ambitious rail networks not just for Metro Manila, but throughout the country when the Japan International Cooperation Agency completes its 30-year railway master plan for the Philippines. Johnson Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
With the upcoming opening of the first phase of the LRT1 Cavite extension, travel to major transport hubs in Metro Manila such as the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange and the Ninoy Aquino International Airport expected to become more convenient. Andrea Taguines reports.
As soon as passengers enter the New Asia World Station of LRT1, they will notice that the ticketing area is more spacious compared to old stations. The facilities are new, like this ticket vending machine and the turnstiles. There's a nursing room for new mothers, a first aid room, and a separate comfort room for persons with disability. Escalators and elevators also offer convenience to commuters heading to the platform. This is just one of the five new train stations that will open this November 16 under the first phase of the LRT1 Cavite extension. The Light Rail Manila Corporation said its Generation 4 train sets are ready to keep passengers cool and comfortable, especially during the Christmas travel rush.
Yung mga bagong stasyon natin are better designed, no? Better designed in terms of connectivity and accessibility. Here at PITX, magiging mas convenient sa ating mga commuters dahil it will be easier for them to travel to and from the LRT1 station.
That's because the station, also dubbed as the PITX station, is right across the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange.
With all this talk of accessibility, you may be wondering, how easy is it to actually cross from here to the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange? Well, there's actually direct access. So if I were to go home to the province this Christmas with all my luggage, as soon as I get off the train and onto the platform, I wouldn't need to cross the street or ride a tricycle or a jeepney. All I need to do is walk a few steps and I'm already here at the third floor parking entrance of the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange.
Commuter John Gerald Remirata says he can't wait until the station opens so he can just transfer trains from the MRT to the LRT going to PITX instead of also having to ride the EDSA bus carousel.
Hassle po kasi po marami pong hagdanan yung pababa tsaka paakyat tapos pababa na din po ulit para lang makapunta doon sa carousel. Lalo na po kanina, ito may dala akong gamit.
But the LRMC reminds travelers it usually only allows two pieces of luggage and an extra bag as long as passengers can easily carry them. The MIA station is also near the Ninoy Aquino International Airport, but there is no direct access.
A part din ng ginagawa namin is talking to different transport partners para lang din yung magkakaroon ng mga designated shuttles or even yung mga with the LGU especially.
The first phase of the LRT1 Cavite Extension project is expected to cut the travel time from Quezon City to Parañaque to just less than an hour, with an end-to-end fare of 45 pesos. Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista also hopes it would help ease road congestion, especially during the holidays. The Transportation Department is now also eyeing to extend the operating hours of other train lines this Christmas season as another way to lessen traffic.
If there's a need to extend, we can extend on our own, no? LRT2 and MRT3. No? Siguro we can extend it up to mga 11 in the evening. No?
Currently, the LRT2 closes at 9:30 in the evening, while the MRT3 ends operations at 10:09 p.m. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Let's now listen in to some of the remarks of President Marcos at the ongoing LRT1 extension inauguration.
Commute. Above all, as one of the biggest and most complicated public works at that time, it instilled pride in our people and reinforced the belief that Filipino talent and ingenuity can always overcome any odds. It broke bureaucratic reluctance to tackle the grand and the enduring, instead of being contented with the temporary and piecemeal. On this day, no one is happier than his son in seeing that his father's foresight is being validated by another work that expands mass transit that he had built for the people that he loved. The L1C project has been a long time in the making, spanning five administrations, starting with President Estrada to President Arroyo, President Aquino, President Duterte, and now to mine. We owe this progress and to the hard work and dedication of my predecessors. We must recognize their roles in helping making this dream a reality. And as we unveil the phase one of the L1C project, we are reminded of the simple yet powerful truth. The way forward is guided by learning from the past and honoring the values and traditions that shape our path towards a better future. The phase one extends the LRT1 line one, bringing us the first five new stations in Parañaque City. These stations, Redemptorist Asiana, Mia Road, Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange, Ninoy Aquino Avenue, and Dr. Santos, will serve as vital access points for many, many Filipinos. The Dr. Santos Station, formerly known as Sukat, is an intermodal transport facility offering multiple bays for public and private vehicles. This facility exhibits our firm determination to provide efficient, accessible transportation options for all. With a phase one completion, the LRT1 will have the capacity to serve an additional 80,000 passengers every day, significantly enhancing our current ridership. Commuters will now see a great reduction in travel time, allowing them to spend more time with their loved ones. By serving commuters across Metro Manila, Cavite, and neighboring areas, the whole project creates a smoother, more reliable mode of transport. Our journey towards a more seamless and modernized public transportation system does not end here. We are committed to building station after station, reaching as far and as fast as our people's needs dictate. Patuloy pa nating pinapalawak at pinapaganda ito. Tulad na lamang nitong pinagsisinayaan natin ngayon. At the same time, I recognize that countless rail projects, those conceived, broken ground upon, thoroughly studied, and even initially financed during my administration, may not see completion in my term. This is the nature of railway development, if any large-scale development. This is not a short-term endeavor. It requires patience, persistence, and passion and commitment that extends beyond immediate timelines. Rail projects not only commence when soil is first taken from the earth. In fact, most of the heavy lifting is done during the preparations. Our role is to ensure that we have a roster of projects running along the pipeline so that the next generations will assume that these heritage projects and take on the responsibility to finish them. Carrying the lessons of the past, we aim to intensify our work on rail initiatives. The issues on road right-of-way must be resolved fast, and disputes must not hinder work. To attract foreign investment in the transport sector, we should leverage the Public Service Act that removes the 40% cap on foreign investment in railways. Finally, the public-private partnership or PPP hybrid model on L1CE serves as a perfect template for future investment. With these in mind, we are pursuing more transportation projects. Dito sa LRT1 Cavite Extension, hangad ko na matapos ang natitirang tatlong istasyon hanggang Bacoor, Cavite sa lalong madaling panahon. Ukol sa Unified Grand Central Station sa Quezon City na magsisilbing terminal kung saan magtatagpo ang apat na linya, hangad ko na agaran nitong magkukumpleto. Nang sa gayon, handa itong magbigay ginhawa sa mga pasaherong tumatangkilik sa tren araw-araw. Para naman sa MRT7 na tatahak mula sa Quezon City hanggang Bulacan, inaasahan ko na magamit na ito upang maranasan ng tinatayang 300,000 pasahero ang pangakong 35 minutong biyahe sa magkabilang dulo. Sabik na rin akong makatanggap ng panyaya sa pagbubukas ng unang yugto ng North-South Commuter Railway. Hangad ko rin na maging komportable ang mga pasahero sa MRT3, sa EDSA at sa LRT1. Hindi na sana kailangan maglakad ng mga pasahero mula sa MRT3 North EDSA Station na malapit sa Trinoma para lang lumipat sa FPJ Station papuntang Balintawak o sa Caloocan. At this point, I would like to express our gratitude to the people behind the success of L1CE Phase 1 completion. Of course, the DOTR that has played a central role in all of this. The Light Rail Transit Authority, the project concessionaire, the Light Rail Manila Corporation, including our financial stakeholders and contractors, for providing the Filipino people with safe, reliable, and efficient transportation services. If ease of travel is key to prosperity, then it is in the railways that we find the drivers for growth. When we connect our hubs and our heartlands through a reliable, efficient transportation system, a people's system accessible to all, we foster a truly inclusive and connected nation. Together, let us build a more advanced, progressive, and prosperous Bagong Pilipinas, one where every Filipino can look towards a future of seamless connectivity, improved mobility, and the freedom to spend time on what truly matters. I took note of MVP's quotation of the Colombian president, and this is this has been actually what I have told all in the transport system and why I have put so much emphasis on rail transport. And that is my experience in taking I've been riding trains for most of my life. simply because as a student and as a young man, it was simply the most convenient. But I think that anyone who has had any experience commuting in big cities like New York or London or Paris, you can see that the ridership is a mixed bunch. And it's not only ordinary workers who are going to work, but you also see people who clearly are people with yung may kaya. Yung mga may kaya magkaroon ng limousine, magkaroon ng naka Rolls Royce sila, naka parada sa bahay. Ngunit ang ginagawa nila, sumasakay sila sa tren. Dahil yan ang pinakamabilis, yan ang pinakamaganda, at yan ang pinakaginhawa na paraan upang makarating sa kanilang pagtatrabahuhan. And that is the point at which when we can see as we refer to them, the rich folk riding the trains in as a matter of choice before riding their fancy automobiles going to work, simply because it is the quickest way there, it is the easiest way there, then I can say we have succeeded at least partway in what we have been aspiring to do. This is the Philippines we strive for, a nation that moves forward as one. Maraming salamat po, mabuhay po ang bagong Pilipinas.
Thank you, Mr. President. At this point,
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. at the inauguration of the LRT1 Cavite Extension Project, which was built on his father's original LRT project decades ago. The Phase 1 unveiled today with 5 new stations in Parañaque, which provides vital access to points in southern Luzon, even the country's airport and a major bus terminal, the PITX. Now, the train routes expected to serve at least 80,000 passengers every day. The president there vowing to provide seamless and modernized transportation in many other railway projects to be inaugurated in Metro Manila soon. Converge ICT Solutions teams up with Netflix to offer a new bundle combining fiber internet and a Netflix plan. Now, this marks Converge's expansion beyond connectivity with plans to partner with other streaming services and offer smart home solutions in the future. Now, the bundle includes a Wi-Fi 6 modem, an experience box with free entertainment channels, and a speed boost for Netflix streaming. Prices start at 1,798 pesos per month, with existing subscribers able to add Netflix for 298 pesos. Converge plans to reach 3 million subscribers by year end, following a 29% increase in net income from January to September of 2024. Philippine gaming industry's gross gaming revenues jumped 37.5%. to over 54 million pesos in the third quarter of 2024. Now, PAGCOR says the surge was driven by the electronic gaming sector's fivefold revenue growth to 35.7 billion. PAGCOR Chair and CEO Alejandro Tenco says they expect the e-game sector to bring in 78 billion pesos in license fees alone. Meanwhile, licensed casinos remain the biggest contributor, bringing in revenues of 50.7 billion pesos, slightly lower than last year's 51.9 billion.